Welcome everyone to a review session for Fluids or Chemins 204, Fluid Mechanics. My name is Sarah, pronouns for you, her. I'm the AVP academic of the Material Society. I'm joined by Huda, who's another AVP academic, as well as Anushree, who's on the Chemins Club. And then Carmine helped organize this, but unfortunately he is feeling under the weather, so he will not be here tonight, also representing the Chemins Club. So this is some epic Chemins materials collab to bring you the best review session possible. Yay, we love that. Before we begin, I'm just going to drop a few links in the chat as per usual. So we have, just for some resources for this, then we have an anonymous questions document in case you're like, wow, I want to ask questions, but I don't want, you know, people to judge me. First of all, no judgment here, but regardless, if you're more comfortable, feel free to drop them in there. We also have a course resource folder, and this has resources not only for fluids, but for any courses, any core materials courses. And for the Chemins folks, that also includes math. In case you're currently taking that, we have a whole bank of resources there. And finally, we have a feedback form because we hope to host many of these review sessions in the future, and we want to make them as basically as beneficial as possible. So that's kind of the brief intro there, the resources. Friendly reminder that I did post on these notes, as well as some the solutions to what I'll be working through earlier up in the Teams. So you can find those there if you want to follow along or if you want to check over afterwards. A bit of the structure. So we'll start by going over the 2020 test too. So I'll be going over that. Next, we can have a Q&A session. So that will be hosted. So both me and then Anushree from Chemins Club will help answer any questions you have. A quick disclaimer is that this was initially scheduled from 7 to 8:30, but there's a high likelihood that it will go over because the tests are intended to be written in 2 hours. So chances are we might, like, if the Q&A ends up being like having any sort of significant time, it might be over 1.5 hours, but it will stay recorded the entire time. Just a quick disclaimer, as per usual, is that we're both students and we are not going to be perfect, but we'll try our best to help out. And if you do have any questions that we can't answer, just throw it in the MS Teams or message Vince or message one of the TAs and they can help you out. If you have any questions over the course of the event, just drop them in the chat or throw them in the anonymous questions document and we'll try and get to them as soon as we can. Basically, after this, then if you want to get in contact with either the society or with the Chemins Club, then here's how you can do that. So we have Instagram, our emails, and our websites. And we both societies and clubs have really great events. I know that there is a pizza event for the Chemins Club, for all the Chemins folks there, after the midterm tomorrow. So basically just stay connected, you know, get involved. It's a great time. Without further ado, then I will move along into midterm. Whoa. Alrighty, so this is from 2020. Note that the 2020 test on course resource, I believe we only have the solutions document. So I made a blanked out document where I just put like really big purple marker over top of all the answers, because then when you're going through it, you don't automatically see the answer. And I just took screenshots of that for this, but there still will be sections like down there where there's just the purple blotted out bit and it will look a little weird, but we get the point across. And again, this test was meant to be written in 2 hours. I think they were given 4 hours. I'm not quite sure why, but anyways, we'll try and get through it as fast as we can. So I'll actually get started now. The first question is some short answer questions. I don't know if we'll get one of these ourselves because this is a really typical first question, but Vince, when he went over the outline, he didn't really include a question relating like kind of short answer quick rapid hit questions like this. So I don't really know what to expect, but it's good to go over just for the conceptual stuff there. The first question asks us for pressure driven flow of a liquid in a circular pipe. We want to find the relationship between maximum axial velocity and the average axial velocity for both laminar and turbulent. And this we can take just from our notes. I believe it's also, I posted formula sheets up on course resource as well as some useful tables when you're studying. And I believe this is just on those notes, and if not, they should be in the slides. So for a laminar, over the max velocity is equal to 1/2. That means that the average velocity is 1/2 of the maximum velocity when traveling the axial direction. Pretty simple. When you get into turbulent, it's a little bit more complicated because you have really fancy, like when you're trying to find the velocity, you have really fancy terms with logs and ends, and it's kind of confusing. But we can generally approximate that the average over the maximum velocity is roughly 4/5, which of course is equal to 0.8. That's all we really have to write for that question. It's pretty simple. Next, it asks us to approximate the Reynolds number equation for flow through a cylindrical pipe, where we want to not approximate, sorry, we want to derive basically using flow rate and kinematic viscosity. Here we can just start by writing out the Reynolds number equation. That's the first step, right? So RE is equal to PVD over mu. But we know that we want the kinematic viscosity, right? We don't want mu, we want the kinematic viscosity, which is whatever that fancy V is. And then we want, we don't want the velocity, we want the flow rate. So here what I'm gonna do is I'll just write kind of some formulas off to the side. The first one we know is that the velocity is equal to the volumetric flow rate over the area. And then we can rewrite this using diameter to be the volumetric flow rate, you know, over pi over 4d squared. And then because I don't like fractions and fractions, I will call this 4q over pi d squared. Next, we know that the kinematic viscosity, basically we know that the dynamic viscosity, here, we know that kinematic viscosity, if you remember from first term or the first part of the semester, is equal to the kinematic viscosity, or sorry, the dynamic viscosity divided by the density. So we can say that the dynamic viscosity is equal to the density times the fancy V. I see a question being like, how do you know which Reynolds number equation to use when there's like three? Use whichever ones you have variables for. Basically, they're the exact same thing. So I guess I could have written this, oh, what's the other Reynolds flow equation? I could have written this immediately as for rho Q over pi mu D. And this is the exact same equation. So I guess that would actually simplify it because then I already have Q in there. Honestly, I started with the first equation because this is used a lot more in the second term. Or the second part of the course, which is what we're going through right now. But you could for sure start with that and just work through it. When you're going through problems, it's whichever you have the variables for. So whether, there's literally no difference, gotta be honest. Anyways, what we can do from there on is we can just kind of take these and plug them in. So actually I'll do what Farrah suggested. And we'll start with this, or Farrah was kind of questioning. We'll start with this one here. And now we don't need to sub in anything for the velocity, right? So we can just kind of ignore that little derivation or that little kind of simplification I did down there. And we'll just throw this term in. So if we throw that in there, we'll end up with equals 4 rho q over pi d. And now we sub in rho times the v for the kinematic or for the dynamic viscosity. And if we cancel out the rho terms for density, we end up with a value of 4q over pi d times the V, whatever that would actually be for the kinematic viscosity. And that's our final answer, 4Q over pi dV. So you get the same one, basically, whichever formula you use. Next, it asks us about the Bernoulli equation. And it's like, okay, we defined a term called rate of flow work. And basically, we want to derive this. So the first thing we could do is be like, okay, what is this term? What is the rate of flow work? You don't necessarily, I don't know if you need to know that before you actually start the question, but I definitely looked at this and I was like, I have no idea what that is. So I went back to my notes and I was like, when did we derive the Bernoulli equation? And I found it. And basically, what we said is that like the rate of work, which is, you know, the rate is just the dot over top and we work. And it was like some fancy like integrals. So like CS times P over rho times rho V dot DA. And I'm like, wow, that's really confusing. But you can simplify this to be equal to P over rho times the mass flow rate, which is a lot easier to work with. And I can kind of go through how we go from the first equation to the next one when I actually derive it properly. But basically, this is what we're trying to get as a final answer. So to do this, we're going to start. It asks us to start with the equation that relates work to force and distance. So this is good old 1DO3 concepts. So we have work is equal to force times distance. Nice. But it asks us to derive it for the rate of flow work. So remember, what you're doing with rates, then it's going to be like something over time. So I'm literally just going to take this and I'm going to put it over time. I'm like, okay, I don't really know what's going on, but I know it's a rate. I know there's going to be some sort of time as a denominator, the denominator words. So I do that, and now I'm like, okay, how can I simplify this? Like, how can I kind of, if I know this is, like, even if I don't know how to derive it, if I just have this given, you know, gross integral, I'm like, I want some of those same terms in the one that I'm currently deriving. So the first thing we can use, like, oh, how do we get rid of the force? So what we can use is the equation that force is equal to pressure times area. So that's the first one. Next, we don't want distance because we don't have distance in our final equation. So we can basically use, we don't have distance, but we know we have velocity in the final one, right? Like that's that little v with e. Should be an arrow to show that it's a vector and not, anyways, we know that we want velocity. So we can know that velocity is equal to distance over time. So therefore the distance is the velocity times time. So again, just some kind of basic formulas. We're gonna throw those in. And we will end up with pressure times area times for the force times velocity times time all over time. So then the times cancel out. We get pressure times area times velocity. But that's not quite where we're at yet. So now we're just going to, a fancy trick we can do in here is basically we're going to divide this by the density, right? We're going to divide the pressure by the density, but then we're also going to multiply it by the density. So overall, we're not actually changing the equation. We're just multiplying it and dividing it by the exact same thing. But now what we can do, if I just bring this up there, is now we have, you know, the equals to P over rho, and then we have like area times velocity times rho. And area times velocity, right, that's equal to the volumetric flow rate. So we can write this as Q rho. And now the volumetric flow rate times the density, that's equal to the mass flow rate. So we can rewrite this as P over rho times the mass flow rate. And that can be basically our final answer for the derivation. Hopefully that's pretty straightforward. Again, if you ever have any questions, just drop them in the chat, or Huda can watch the anonymous question doc as well, and she'll just yell at me. Moving on, so now it asks us, it lists the roughness of common pipe materials. Do you expect these values to increase or decrease? And the solutions document like circled one of these, which is why I had to blank it all out. Apologies for the messy writing, but regardless, hopefully you can read it. And basically it's like, okay, so we have common pipe materials, and are these going, the roughness, is it going to increase or decrease with pipe age? So here we're like, what happens to pipes as they age? And basically what happens is they get rust. And rust increases friction, and friction increases the roughness. Wow. So basically we just say that the roughness, or the E value, is going to increase. And that's just because of friction from rust. So that's pretty straightforward, just dealing with losses over time. And you can, even if you're like, oh, if you're not sure about this, if you're like kind of questioning yourself, if you look at the table, then you can like look at the like, oh, the new cast iron, or like the worn cast iron, or the rusty cast iron, and you can see that the roughness values increase over the course of those, like that progression. So yeah, you can always just look at those tables to try and get a guess as well. Next, it asks us for some conditions to use the Blasius equation. And the first equation, the first condition here, again, just kind of from the notes, is that we need to have a smooth pipe. And smooth pipes, then the roughness is equal to zero. And the second condition we need, is there specific restrictions on the Reynolds number? So basically the Reynolds number is between 4,000 and 100,000. So you can have a super turbulent flow in this, to use this equation. Moving onwards. Next, it asks us to basically describe pump performance curves and explain why there's differences here. And this was on like the end of some like Turbo Machinery 2, I want to say. But basically, pump performance curves, we have the head on the y-axis, and then we have the volumetric flow rate on the x-axis. And an ideal curve basically has like a linear relationship there. So pretend that's straight. I'll just call that ideal. Right? It's pretty chill there. But in reality, then you have kind of something that looks like this. And on the initial slide, then if you go look at it, then it like describes what each of these different regions like represents. And I don't really, you know which region it represents or why. But what we need to know here is that we have a decrease in the head, in actual curves or in actual pumps. And this is because of just like any sort of generic losses that you can think of. So that can be due to friction or any like additional turbulence or any like leaks you might have in the pump or in the system. Just any sort of potential cause like that, that's just like, oh, what could be going wrong in a system, in a pump, that's going to cause some sort of decrease in the head flow. Make that full screen. Next, we're given these values, so it's like a times b times c, and we're like, okay, what do these mean? So the first two numbers in this, those represent the diameters of the inlet and the outlet of a pump, or otherwise known as the suction and the discharge. And what we got to realize here is that the larger number is always the inlet diameter. So in that case, that's going to be the 3 inch. So that's going to be the inlet diameter, which is otherwise known as suction. I just like calling it inlet. I don't know why, I just like that better. And then the 1.5 is going to be the outlet diameter, otherwise known as discharge. So again, this could have been in the opposite direct or the opposite order. Could have been like 3 inch times 1.5 inch, or 1.5 inch, and you still would have gotten the 3 inch is the inlet and the 1.5 is the outlet. So the order doesn't matter. We look at the actual sizes of them to determine which is which. And then finally, the last value or the last number is always going to be last, and this is the largest pipe size, and it's the nominal pipe size. Like it's given in inches, and it's like that's not the actual diameter. Just the nominal pipe size, and that's in the given series. So here you have a whole series of pumps, and it's like, oh, which kind of pump do you want in this like certain like standard? And it's like, okay, this is the largest one that they have for the pipes. Next, this is a fun question, part H. This one totally tripped me up when I was doing this because pumps are wild. And it's like basically, okay, so we have a centrifugal pump and we want to throttle the flow, and we're like, which of these valves is best to use? And once again, it had circled the right answer, so I blotted it out. And what we got to realize here, sorry, just going back, the bigger number is the inlet. Yes, you are correct. The bigger number, so that's in this case, it's 3 inches, always the inlet. Anyways, here we're like throttling the flow, and the first thing I got to realize is what does throttling the flow actually mean? And maybe like Chemens people have actually like focused more on that, but I was like, man, I've not been always paying attention in class. I don't know what that means. So basically, throttling the flow means that the flow or like the valve is going to be adapting over time to maintain a constant like difference in pressure. So you have this pump, you know, like whatever. Centrifugal pump, you go in, it's coming out, and it's like, oh, depending on what's going in, and you might get like a different amount of flow going out depending on the time, but we want to have like, and then you have some sort of valve. I think that's the symbol for valve, and we want to have a constant flow going out of the pump, like going out after that valve. But in here, this is non-constant. So what we want is we want that valve. Whoa, I don't want to. We want this valve to be able to adapt without changing it. So it needs to be able to adapt on the fly. And if you want to learn more about these pumps, or if you're like me and you're like, oh, what if a question like that gets asked on the test and I have no idea what to expect, then number one, it is open device. So you can look in your like the so you can look at your lecture notes without having to like print all of them off. But number two, is that he did post like or he recommended reading this one page or paper all about centrifugal pumps and how to deal with those valves. So that's where I went to go read actually up on this question. I was like, why on earth do we need to use a certain valve over the other? So I'd recommend, even if you don't necessarily read it or you don't have time, you can just download it and have it up on your device if you're taking that, or print it off if you're sticking with paper notes, just to reference for you need it. Anyways, so we went over the theoretics, but which one do we actually use? And here we use the globe valve. For those exact reasons, basically, it's able to kind of adapt to that change in flow. It can modulate like up and down without like setting a specific state. Like for example, the ball valve, or like I'm pretty sure you have to like rotate it or open and close in it. Same with like the check and the gate, they can't really change. So that's why the globe valve is the best option. Anyways, next it asks us to calculate the hydraulic diameter of this duct shown. And we used this actually in a tutorial question at some point. I think it was last week. But basically, what happens here is that we have fluid going in this. Here, I'll do it with a highlighter instead. We have fluid going in between the two ducts. So you have fluid going in there, and we're like, okay, what is the hydraulic diameter? The key here is realize what is a hydraulic diameter. And basically, we have this equation, dH equal to 4a over p, where a is the cross-sectional diameter. Oh, that's not, I don't know what I'm saying. That's the cross-sectional area. And then the p is the wetted perimeter. And basically the cross-sectional area is like, okay, what area is the fluid actually flowing through? And the wetted perimeter is like, what parts of the duct are physically touching the liquid that's flowing? So to start, if we think about the area, that's just going to be that blue area that I highlighted. So if you want to visualize that, that's going to be the area of the cube, or the area of the square, minus the area of the circle. So we can write that out as like, oh yeah, if I call the side length S, and this here I'm going to call it D for the diameter, that would be, you know, S squared minus pi over 4D squared is equal to the area. Next, for the perimeter, so here instead of like subtracting them, we need to take the total perimeter that's being wetted, that's touching the fluid. So that's both for the circle. So we see that, whoa. Anyways, the wetted perimeter would be touching, like we see on the inside with the circle, that's touching the fluid, and also on the square, that's also touching the fluid. So we're going to add them up together. So it's going to be the perimeter of the square plus the perimeter of the circle. That's just going to be 4 times S, you know, 4 times the side length, plus the circumference of a circle would be pi times D. And we plug those all in, so we get DH is equal to 4. You know, you get S squared minus pi over 4D squared over 4S plus pi D. And I'm not going to plug in those numbers, but if you were to calculate it all out, if you were to calculate that all out, you would get a value of 121.88 millimeters as your hydraulic diameter. So that's all like kind of the rapid fire questions at the beginning. Hopefully that helps with your conceptual. When you go back and do the other past tests, then a lot of them are like literally word for word the exact same question as this. So I don't know if we can expect a section like this, because Vince knows that we have access to the past tests. But just good to kind of refresh yourself on these concepts before we get into the questions. Assuming there's no questions, before we move on, I'll just go for it. So here we're starting with a mass balance question. And Vince said to expect two mass balance questions, remember, one being steady state and one being transient. So we'll start here. And it's like, okay, drilling fluid is being pumped steadily down, so it's always circled. Remember, when we see steadily, that just means steady state, so no mass accumulation. Okay, I'll just go back to that question quick before I move on to this. A globe valve is the best option because it can change during operation of the centrifugal pump. I believe so, yes. I will put the disclaimer that pumps is like my worst part of fluid mechanics, so I don't want to like be quoted on that, but from my understanding of globe valves, then it can change like during operation. So that's why it's the best choice. Hopefully that answers your question. I don't see any follow-ups. So anyways, back to this. So it's steadily pumped. So that means, again, that dm over dt is equal to zero. And it's going through the center pipe of a well, then it rises up. So basically it goes in the center and then out the kind of outer area. So if I were to redraw this cross-sectional area, then basically it's similar to what we just had. It's like, okay, so we have this inner area where it's going in, then we have this outer area where it's all going down. And we're like, okay, we just got to make sure that we deal with the proper areas here. And it's like, yeah, we need to figure out what the inner diameter is when we're given the outer diameter. And we know the key here also that it says is that the average velocity of the fluid remains the same in both regions. So that means that basically V1 is equal to V2. If I call going in is equal to 1 and out is equal to 2, we can try and figure this out. So the first part in writing and basically any mass balance equation ever is to write out the generic form. So dm dt is equal to the sum of mass flow rate in minus the sum of mass flow rate out. But we already determined that it's zero going, there's zero accumulation, and then we can get rid of kind of the sigma signs because we know that there's only one source going in and only one source going out. So now we have mass flow rate in equal to mass flow rate going out. So now we can rewrite it because we know that the mass flow rate is equal to density times the volumetric flow rate. We have P1 Q1 is equal to P2 Q2. Remember, I'm just simplifying into 1 and out to 2 because that's what's easier. And because it's the same fluid both times, we assume it's incompressible. We can cancel out the densities because it'll be the same on both sides. So now we can also rewrite Q is equal to velocity times area. So now we have V1A1 is equal to V2A2. Here, I'll just zoom in a little bit so you can see it better. Anyways, V2A2. But remember, we already set up here that the velocities are the same. So I'm going to cancel out those velocities and then just rewrite it using A, pi over 4 d squared, given pi over 4 d1 squared is equal to pi over 4 d2 squared. So these are the same on both sides. We'll cancel that out as well. Oh, wait, I screwed that up. Ignore me. Basically, we know it's d squared, but that's just the generic form for a circle. But we want to actually deal with the area. So for this, for going in, then we just have this inner area, right? So that's just going to be pi over 4 d squared. So I have the d2 side right. But when we're going out, my bad, d1 squared. When we're going out, so that's going to be d2. We're not dealing with the entire like circle here. We're just dealing with the area that I highlighted in blue. So the area there is going to be pi over 4 and then d2 squared minus d1 squared, right? So it's basically like the area, the whole area minus that small inner area. So we can write that as pi over 4 d2 squared minus d1 squared. There we go. That makes a lot more sense. And now if we want to simplify it, we get 2d1 squared is equal to d2 squared. We can take the square root of both sides to get root 2d1 is equal to d2. And then we're solving for d1. So we end up with d1 is equal to d2 over root 2. And if you plug in the value, we were given d2 is equal to 200 millimeters. You plug that in. You get D1 is equal to 141.42 millimeters. Yay. So now that's solved. I'll just wait here for a second in case anybody has some questions before moving on. I'm not seeing any. So, moving forwards. The first question is to write the most general form of the mass balance equation for any control volume with multiple flow rate inlets or outlets. So this is just straight off your formula sheet. Basically, the most general form is what we're given. So dm dt is equal to the sum of mass flow rate in minus the sum of mass flow rate out. Of course, you can always rewrite this being like, okay, dm dt plus the sum rate of mass, or like minus mass in plus the sum of mass out is equal to zero, or you can write it using the fancy vector notation we were taught. Any of those should get you the mark here, whichever one makes most sense to you. Next, we're given a rectangular tank and we want to fill it, and it's being filled with two different pipes, so A and B. And we're given their areas and velocities, and we want to figure out an equation for the liquid level H in the tank with respect to time. So I'm just going to start by rewriting that initial general equation. So dm dt is equal to the sum of mass in minus the sum of mass out. But if we look at the situation, there's no mass going out. There's no outlets to this box, so I can just cancel that out. And then mass in is going to be A plus B because we just have those two inlet sources. So now we can rewrite it dm over dt is equal to m1 or ma plus mb. And now I'm just going to deal with the right hand side of the equation for a bit. So basically, we can simplify this to be, we know that the mass rate is equal to density times flow rate. So you can just say p qa plus, or rho qa plus rho qb. I'll factor out rho, and then we can know that flow rate, the volumetric flow rate is equal to velocity times area. We'll just can say VA, AA plus VB, AB. And now we're done with kind of the right-hand side of the equation. But now we need to deal with the dm/dt, right? Because we're given this, but we want to find the liquid level H. So what we can do here, if I just, I'm going to write this over here so we just have more space. We have d over dt times the mass. So we can rewrite this using d over dt, pressure times volume, or density times volume, not pressure. Density times volume for the mass. And now we assume that it's incompressible. So the density isn't going to be changing. We can take that out. And we can also rewrite the volume given, and we'll just leave it as volume for now. So we're given rho times dV over dt. And now the trick here is that we need to use the chain rule, because we can't just like say, oh, how's the volume changing with time? Because we don't really know that, right? We're like, okay, so we're also trying to find the liquid level H, how that's changing with time. Basically what you want to do is if we want to find dH dt, we can take the chain rule. So we can be like, okay, to take dV dt, we know that this is a function, the volume is going to be a function of the height, right? So just the way driving works is basically we can do rho, then we'll have dH, or not dH, dV over dH. So we take it with respect to H, and then we do dH over dt. And you don't actually really need to know why we do this, as long as you remember this step here, that we change dV dt into dV dH, dH dt. So that's the key, is that we're left with this equation here. And now you're like, okay, but what is the volume? Like, how do we take the volume, and what do we do with those terms? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to forget all the derivatives, like forget all those, you know, equations, whatever. We'll just figure out what is the volume of this. So if I do that up here in the top right corner, I know that the volume is going to be equal to base times length times height for just any cylinder. And then we see, okay, now we have S and S, so it's just going to be S squared times height. And now I can be like, okay, what's dV over dH? Because now I look at that equation, I'm like, okay, I need to figure out what that is. So we just take the derivative of this equation with respect to height. So we have dH times S squared H. That's pretty simple. It's just going to end up being S squared, right? Because you take the derivative that acts as a constant, just cancel the H out. Wow, easy as that. So we can rewrite this equation then basically as rho times S squared times dH over dt. And of course you can do this while it's still actually in the equation. I just like to kind of separate it just so my mind doesn't get jumbled thing of doing 8,000 different things at once. But basically I'm going to take this and I'm going to plug it back in. So now we have dm dt, and we worked it out to be equal to rho times S squared times dH over dt. The first thing I see is that I have rho on both sides of the equation. I'm going to cancel that out, so we don't no longer have the rho down there. And then I can bring that S squared over to the denominator. So we end up with the final value, the final equation of dH. Oh, I don't want that to be in blue. dH over dt is equal to that, like the velocities and the areas, over S squared. And that's our final answer for this. If you don't want to worry about derivations, module 6 gives you the, yes, that's a really good point, Huda. If you don't want to worry about the conceptuals behind this, then just follow kind of the workflow that was given. We also, on the other side of that kind of set on module 6, gives you all of it for gases as well, in case we have to deal with gases and ideal gases. So it would be very handy to have that. That could also work. That's a good point, Huda. I honestly didn't even think about that when I was solving this. I just treated it as a... Yeah. So.
Yeah, let's see. Is the cross-sectional area constant? And if it is, then I just use the easy equation. And if it's like a pyramid where the volume changes with the height, or like the area changes with the height, then I go on to the derivation.
Excellent. Thank you for bringing that up, Huda. I appreciate it. So regardless of the path you choose, you'll end up with this final answer. And now it wants us to calculate the time to raise the liquid level in the tank, given a bunch of details. So The first thing I'm going to do, just to keep it easier, what I did when I was making the solutions is I wrote it all out using variables, and I just plugged things in at the end. But that is a lot of work, and I'm lazy. So what I'm going to do is I see all these values here, you know, the velocities, the side length, that's going to be constant, right? We're not going to be changing the inlet area. We're not going to be changing the side length of this pyramid. So I can just calculate what that is. If I do VA, AA plus VB, AB over S squared. Oh, I don't actually know what that would be. Basically, if you calculate that, you end up with the value of 3.73 times 10 to the negative 3. And we don't really need to know what this, like, necessarily worries about. That's just kind of the rate that the height is increasing, so that'd be, like, I don't know, meters per second. But regardless, we just have that value. And I'm just going to denote this because I'm lazy. I'll just leave it as a number. Never mind. Ignore me. Anyways, we're given dh over dt is equal to that equation we just figured out, which is 3.73 times 10 to the minus 3. We need to figure out the time. So here we go back to math and taking our, you know, whatever these are called. I don't even know. And basically, what we want to do is we're going to bring that dt around. So we end up with dh is equal to 3.73 times 10 to the negative 3 dt. Now we're like, okay, now we have an integrating factor on both sides. We'll take the integral. Wow. So we're going to take an integral of both sides. And now the tricky part here is to figure out what the integrating variables are going to be. Generally, it's a pretty good standard. You can set for the dh. I'll just zoom in a little bit. We're going to set it as the initial height. So h0 going up to some sort of final height, hf. And then for time, we can go from 0 to time t. So just leaving it as variables for now to treat it as a more generic case. So then you take that, you'll end up, the integral of dh is h. The same with dt is that's going to be t. So h is equal to 3.73 times 10 to the negative 3 t. And that goes from 0 to t. And the h goes from h0 to hf. We end up with hf minus h0 is equal to 3.73 times 10 to the negative 3 t. So now if we were to kind of solve for t and plug it in, you end up with t is equal to h final minus h initial over 3.73 times 10 to the negative 3. And we were given those values for the height, right? 1 meters to 3 meters. So that's going to end up being 3 minus 1 on the numerator. And then if you end up plugging all that in and solving it, you'll end up with the value of 535.71 seconds. And of course, it's seconds because you've been doing everything in SI units, so meters per second. But we got to realize, and I remember this on the first midterm, so trying to keep it in mind heading into tomorrow, is that it often specifies what units it wants for the answers, right? And I almost missed this on like 5 questions on the first midterm, so I'm like trying really hard to make sure I figure this out for this midterm, is that it wants it in minutes. So we can't just give the answer in seconds. We just got to convert it. Pretty easy, you know, 1 minute over 60 seconds. You divide it by 60, you'll end up with a value of 8.93 minutes to fill the tank. And then, of course, it's never a bad idea to look at your answer and be like, is that reasonable? Yeah, that seems like a legit amount of time. That's a hefty tank. And yeah, that's that question. I'll pause here for a little bit in case people want to throw any questions in the chat or if you just want a breather. I will say the next question was covered in tutorial 7. Do you folks want me to go through that question, or in the nature of time, just kind of skip over it? And you can look at the tutorial answers, look at the solutions that I posted for this. What would you prefer? Any strong opinions? Because I was thinking, just so we have more time to go over the final questions, skipping over it because people have seen it before. But if there's people who are like, no, Sarah, I really want you to go over that question, then I will do it. Like, I have the solutions to it. I know how it works. No strong opinion. I'm not hearing anyone else with another strong opinion, so I'm going to skip over it. Reminder that I think there are tutorial recordings for some of the classes. You can ask question 4. Okay, can we do question 4, please? Yes, just for you, Natasha. Skip? Oh, wait. How would I do question 4 at the end? So then people who are like, okay, I don't do that again, they can leave. Without missing. Yeah, let's do that. We'll come back to number 4. We'll do the other ones first, and we'll get back to 4. So question 5. This is a lovely question. So basically, we're given this lovely system, so many valves, wow. And it's supposed to pump water at 10 degrees C through some sort of horizontal pipe between two reservoirs. And it's not to scale, whatever. And then we're given is 2 meters, and this is going entering the pump is 2 meters of 2.5 schedule 40 galvanized steel pipe. We're given the absolute roughness, which is nice. Then the discharge line from the pump is 20 meters of 2 and schedule 40 galvanized steel pipe. So that's just a lot of information. So when I'm given a question like this, I'm going to start by just writing everything I have down. So the first thing I'm going to do is everything leading up to the pump, I'm going to denote as 1, just so I don't need to write, like, you know, suction, like entering. It's just going to be 1, and then everything after the pipe is going to be 2. Just to clear things up. Next, let's just write some things down. So on the first side, we have the length is equal to 2 meters. We are given that. We're given the nominal diameter is equal to 2.5 in schedule 40. And remember, these are not the actual diameters because we love whoever designed these piping systems. So basically, you're going to find a table that should be attached at the back of the test and figure out, okay, what's the 2.5 inch schedule pipe, like schedule 40. Find the internal diameter, and we're going to figure that out to be D1 is equal to 6.271 centimeters. Next, we know that, just in general, we know that the absolute roughness is, okay, actually, I'll do it the second part. So L2 is equal to 20 meters. The nominal diameter 2 is equal to 2 inch, scheduled 40. So if you find that, we'll end up with the diameter 2 is equal to 5.252 centimeters. Some generic things that we're given. So if you look at the standards for water at 10 degrees C, we can figure out that the density is 1,000 kilograms per meter cube. And then we also, just given in the question, we're given that the absolute roughness is 0.15 millimeters, so that's small e. And we know that it's horizontal. We notice it's a horizontal pipe, so we can also note that as well. Another thing, technically, when you're doing questions like this, which we'll end up writing the Bernoulli equation in case you haven't realized already, is we need to figure out like a point to actually be 1 or 2. So I'm going to choose like a generic point that we can use. I'm just going to choose this point right on the top of the reservoir and this point right there on the top of the reservoir. So here we can see that we're also at the same height at 8 meters there. So Z1 is equal to Z2. Because, of course, it can be a horizontal pipe, but if we have different reference points at different heights, then that's not necessarily equal height. And we also can see that it's vented reservoir. So these are going to be the atmospheres, or they're open to the atmosphere. So the pressure is going to be equal to the atmospheric pressure. So those are some key situational things to figure out. Farah, I'll get to your question once we start writing out the Bernoulli's equation. So next, I'm just going to figure out what the roughness is of the pipes, because I know I'm going to need that later on. I'm just kind of throwing down everything that I could possibly need in this question. So we know that the relative roughness, you know, that little, I don't actually know what that's called, the little backwards three, that looks like an E, is equal to the absolute roughness divided by the diameter. So basically, we could take that and we want to divide it by the diameter 1, by diameter 2. The key when calculating this is that they all have to be in the same units, because of course the relative roughness is unitless. So you can put them all in epsilon. Thank you, Hugo. We can put them all in millimeters. We can put them in centimeters, in meters, whichever we want, as long as it's constant. And we'll get a value of epsilon 1 is equal to 2.392 times 10 to the negative 3. And epsilon 2 is equal to 2.856 times 10 to the minus 3. Next, I'm just going to go through and be like, okay, what are, I'm not sure we need these values right now, but this just, we don't actually need these to solve A, just like a disclaimer. But personally, when I see a question like this, I get overwhelmed very easily. I'm like, there are a lot of things to deal with right now. Oh my gosh. And the way that makes me feel better is just writing down all my givens, writing down all my equations, being like, well, I have no idea what I'm doing, but at least I have some information there and I can see what things that I could solve for and what things that I don't have. So just to kind of go on to that, I'm going to talk a little bit about the fittings here. So in the first section, then we have, so where we're given these valves, the pump, then we have this check valve, butterfly valve. So we're given those valves, right? But what's key here is that we also are going to have fittings or k-values associated with the entrance and with the exit. So on the first side, I'll just under k1, the k-entrance, I'll just do k-enter. This is going to always be equal to 0.5, or basically always equal to 0.5, because you just approximate it as like a rectangle entrance. And there are, I think, values for this on one of the slides, which once again, I posted all of the relative or all of the relevant slides with tables on the on-course resource folder in case you're curious. Anyway, so we have that, and next we have the gate valve. If you look at that, again, just in one of those slides, you'll find out that being a value of 0.15. Reminder, you don't need to have any of these tables available with you, because we will be given all of the variables we need to solve the questions in the test. But regardless, I'm just going to sub that in. I'm just going to add them all up just for ease, 0.65. I'm going to do the same thing with K2. So if we look up the swing style check valve, you end up with K check is equal to 2.5. It's pretty hefty. The K butterfly is equal to, when it's 10 degrees open, that will be equal to 0.52. And next, then you have K exit is going to be equal to 1.0. And that, again, is just when it enters the second reservoir, and that's always going to be equal to 1.0. How far there is a K exit, it's just associated. I put that under the, because I have like two kind of columns going. So this is for one, this is for two. And I put it under two because that's in the second portion of the pipe. If I add all of those up, I'm just going to call this the sum of K2, because I don't want to write them all out every time. Again, this is all of the K values associated after the pump. You'll get a value of 4.02. So there we have all of those sorted out. Now that we've kind of written down all of our equations, we can deal with the Bernoulli equation now. Let's figure that out. I'll just do it to the side. So the Bernoulli equation, one of the questions is, how do we know which Bernoulli equation to use, like the lowercase one or the uppercase one? And this is going to depend on your situation. So sometimes it doesn't matter what you use, right? It's like, oh, because we have, you know, the head form, which is where like everything is in, you know, I'll write this in orange for sentence. So we have the head form where everything is in units of length, so equals to meters, or we have like the, I don't know what it's called, like I think it's the energy form. Yeah, energy, where I think it's like equal to joules per second, but don't quote me on that. And basically we're like, okay, so why do we use one versus the other? And the trick is, it depends on what terms you have and what kind of those units are. So when we're given H pump, so when we're like solving for H pump, that uppercase H indicates that it's in head form. So when it's H pump, you know that's going to be equal to units of meters. Yeah, sorry, I just want to check something to make sure I wasn't telling you something wrong. But yeah, that H pump is going to be equal in units of meters. So because it's in units of meters, we know that it needs to be the head form. And that's going to be basically everything divided by the gravitational constant. This is the same like when we're dealing with, like this is relating to like the major or minor losses. If it's like HLT for the total head loss, that's going to be equal to meters. But if we're given HLT, that's going to be equal to the joules per second. So depending on what values you're given, if you have to deal with the pump, or if you're given a certain value for the head or for the losses due to friction, then you might have to use a specific form, or if it asks us to put it into head form, then you're going to have to do that. But otherwise, it's entirely up to your discretion, whichever you prefer. Generally, I like to go with the energy version because I don't like writing out divided by G like eight times. But in this situation, then because we are dealing with the pump, we're going to have this value here, which means that we need to put it in head form. So hopefully that makes things a little clearer for you. If there's no other questions, then I will start to write it out. Basically, the first thing we're going to do here, because the actual question we haven't actually started yet, is like basically we want to start with the Bernoulli equation. We want to derive the system curve equation. So the first thing is to write out the big honkin' Bernoulli's equation. So we have the head pump, which is equal to meters. So we need to put everything in head form. So let's write P1 for PG. I was going to say everything out as I wrote, and then I realized that would be a lot of talking, and I'm kind of lazy for that. So shall not 2p. I just thought of a really funny joke. Fully open gate valve, k equals 0.20. Oh, I think some of the, depending on what table you use, then you might get very slightly different values. So what did I get for gate valve? Gate 0.15. Here, let me, useful tables and such. Gate valve. Yeah, so here you're right. It says 0.20. Why did I go 0.15? So I remember I got really frustrated. I just went with 0.15 and it matched the solutions document. Yeah, so here on this table, then it says a fully open gate valve is 0.15. So this is where Vince is only going to give us one specific table. And we'll just use the values that are given there. So we won't be given those conflicting values. So if you have a slightly different answer than me, then it's like whatever. I don't know if this is a stupid question, but how are we supposed to know which k values to sum together? Yeah, so here you don't, basically, that's not a stupid question. This was poor explanation on my part. The equation for the minor losses, right? That's what the k values are for, the minor losses. We have the equation like h ln is equal to, I guess it'd be uppercase because we're putting in half form, lm because we're putting in head form. That's going to be equal to sum of k times the characteristic velocity squared over 2g. And the key here is that the k values, right, are dependent on the velocity that they're traveling through. So basically, we want to separate these depending. So you can add these all separately. You know, just be like, okay, k1, v1 squared over 2g plus k2, v2 squared over 2g. And if that's the only way that you can do it without like kind of like tripping yourself up, go for it. You won't be docked any marks, or I assume you won't be docked any marks because that'd be a stupid thing to dock marks for. But I'm lazy, so I wanted to simplify it. So basically what I did is I'm like, okay, when is the velocity going to be changing, right? And the only way it's going to be changing is if we have a changing in pipe diameter. And that happens right at the pump. So right here at the pump, let's draw a big line on the drawing. That's where the diameter changes, right? Because it's like, okay, going in, then we have certain diameters, and going out, then we have another diameter. So now I have the sum of k Vc squared over 2g. And I'm like, okay, so now we have the first velocity, like v1 over 2g times the sum of k plus the second velocity over 2g times the sum of k2. And so this just represents basically k1 is all of the coefficients for that given velocity. So in this case, it's for this given diameter. So that's going to be these two, the entrance and the gate valve. And then with v2, that's for the second diameter. So that's going to be everything after the pump, after the pipe changes. Does that kind of clear things up? Do you want me to explain it a bit more? Yes, as in that makes sense, or yes, as in you want me to explain it more? Okay, I'm gonna take that as a good thing. I'm glad that makes sense. It can be a little overwhelming at first, and k values are just kind of frustrating to work with, but regardless, I'm going to finish writing out this equation. So here's our equation. Okay, I'm sorry, I thought of this when I was writing out the Bernoulli equation. I need to say this pun. I can't. I need to make sure it's like worded appropriately. Who do you have make sure that this the give me a second. I need to work on it with my brain before I actually say it out loud. Okay, anyways, with this equation, now we're given this huge Planck and Bernoulli's equation, right? And we want to simplify it as much as we can because this is a very long equation and I don't like many terms. So the first thing we're going to say is that, remember, we said that both of these reservoirs, like remember the spots we took, the references are open to the atmosphere. And because they're open to the atmosphere, they're going to have the same pressure. So P1 equals P2 equals P atmosphere. And because that's the same, we can just cancel those terms out. Nice. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to remember that these are at the same height as well. So z1 is equal to, oh, we'll make that bigger. Z1 is equal to z2 is equal to 8 meters, but it's the same, right? So those terms cancel out as well. Z1, z2, wow. The next thing we can do is say that the diameter is going to be changing. The diameter is changing, but remember the reference points we took, again, we're at the top, and when you're at the top of a reservoir, then the velocities are essentially zero, right? So we can just write top of reservoir, right? Because like it's moving so fast in the pipe, once you get to that big, you know, big tank, then it's not really moving that fast anymore. So it's like, oh, it doesn't really do anything. So even if there is a teeny tiny bit of velocity, it's insignificant. So we can cancel that out as well, the v1 squared and the v2 squared over 2g. And now we're just left with basically the head pump. The head of the pump is going to be equal to those two terms. And I'm going to basically expand these as well. I need more space. I'm going to expand these to basically similar to what I explained a bit for the minor losses, is we need to split these up into two terms. So split up into 1 and 2. So now I'm just going to rewrite this a little bit. So we have H pump is equal to F1 L1 over D1 times. And now it says the average velocity, but within the given pipe, then the average velocity is just going to be that given velocity. So we'll say V1 squared over 2G plus the sum of K1 V1 squared over 2G plus F2 L2 over D2 times V2 squared over 2G plus sum of K2 V2 squared over 2G. Nice. Now we rewrote it, and now we can look at this and be like, okay, we wrote down a bunch of variables at the start. Which ones do we have and which ones do we still need? So we have things like length, diameter, the K values. But what we don't have, or we don't have quite yet, is we don't know what the velocities are, and we don't know what the friction factors are, those Fs. So I'm going to start with the friction factor F. And here's a jolly good time. So basically what we have, find F. Remember, there's a few different ways you can calculate the friction factor. So to find F, basically you can use a Moody chart. And he said we would be given a Moody chart on the test, so maybe we might be required to, who knows. So we can use a Moody chart, and then you can use like any of the four equations we were given depending on the conditions, but typically we use the Holland equation just because that's just the standard. I don't actually know why, but that's kind of a generic way. So what I did is I used the Holland equation, but keep in mind that the Holland equation has a term including the Reynolds number, right? So we know that F is equal to, like if you were to write out the Holland equation, basically you get -1.8 log then relative roughness over 3.7 to the 1.11, well then it goes 6.9 over RE. But if we look at this, if we actually look at the equation, we're like, oh, but we don't have what the Reynolds number is. That sounds really hard. We say that it says it's in the fully rough regime, which means it's independent of the flow rate. So for this, either what you could do is when you're looking on a Moody chart, right, and you have that, like, whatever, that graph like that, you can just read it off, like, off the graph. Be like, yeah, just draw a horizontal line from whatever your absolute roughness or whatever your relative roughness is to the friction factor and just call it a day. No need for iterations. Or what I did, because I like equations, I don't like charts. Yes, to the power of 2. Thank you, Huda. I forgot that. -2. Yes. Don't forget the -2, folks. Anyways, so you can do that. But what I did is I was like, I like equations. I'm just going to ignore that term in the Holland equation. So I just kind of deleted that. And I just used the rest of it. So like we have the, oh, I forgot like multiple brackets there. Basically, I just used the rest of it. So just ignoring that term, I still had everything else. And now if you calculate that, which I'm not going to write out because time exists, then I'm just going to write out, we can find out that F1 is equal to 0.0246 and F2 is equal to 0.0259. So now we go back to our Bernoulli's equation. We're like, okay, we have F. Nice, we can unhighlight that. Next, we need to find what the velocities are. And the typical way to find velocity, remember, is just velocity is equal to the volumetric flow rate over the area. And we're trying to find this equation. We go back to the actual question. It's like, okay, we need to find the relationship. And we want to find the pump head, the required pump head, relating to the volumetric flow rate. So if we were to rewrite, we want to leave Q as a variable here. So you can just rewrite as Q over pi over 4D squared. And I'm going to sub those values in immediately just because I don't want to deal with a ton of variables. So if I sub those back in and I throw in the D1 and the D2 values, you'll end up with a V1 is equal to 323.77 Q. And then V2 is equal to 461.59 Q. And that's just, you know, the pi over 4 D squared on the denominator. So now I have our velocities. Basically, we're going to take everything, all of this, we're just going to shove it into that equation right there. And I could type this out, but that would take a lot of time. If you want to see it all written out, then you can look at the solutions I posted. And if you do that, all you will get a value for the pump head as 158.447 Q squared. I see that in the chat, we have a question. Yeah, so Natasha asked, can you explain why we don't need RE again or the Reynolds number? And Allison, thank you, said it says to assume the fully rough region, so it's independent of RE. Yeah, so it's kind of like workaround wording. I'll just go over it one more time. Okay, it does make sense. Never mind. Allison got me. Thanks, Allison. Fantastic. So we ended with that value for A's pump. In the nature of time, I'm not writing all that out. But basically, now we're given this question. It's like, okay, now we're given the performance curve as this equation right here, right? And we want to figure out what is the volumetric flow rate of water in the system. And here we got to realize we got to remember what the concept of a duty point or an operating point is, right? And basically that is when you have a graph and then you have like, oh yeah, that's like the, I forget what it's called. I want to say this is the system curve, but I could be wrong. I'm not going to lie. And then we have the performance curve. And basically they're always going to operate right where these meet. And we have like Q and H. That's going to be at a given head value. So basically what we can do is we know that they're going to be at the same, we're going to be at the same head and we're going to be at the same volumetric flow rate. And it wants us to figure out what is the volumetric flow of water. So we can just say HP of 1 is equal to HP of 2. So that's going to be 145 minus 579.30 Q squared. And that's coming directly from the equation or from the question right there. And now we take our answer from part A and sub that back in is equal to 158.447 Q squared. So now we have a pretty, you know, not too difficult equation. You throw all this together, solve, you'll get a value of Q is equal to 0.0259 meters cubed per second. Nice. Finally, we still have more questions, but next it asks us to calculate what is a hydraulic power? And here we just, I don't know if there's a better way to remember this, but what I know is that like basically the power is equal to like the rate of work, which is like there's the equation M over rho is equal, or M over rho times delta P of pump, which is equal to, right, mass, or this is the mass flow rate, which is that's going to be equal to Q times delta P of the pump. We're like, oh boy. We don't actually know what the change in pressure is, like over the course of the pump. So you'd be like, okay, instead of writing that out, what we can remember is the actual equation for HP is equal to delta P of the pump over rho times G. That's like the actual equation for what the pump head is. So we can sub in the delta P of the pump. Basically, so we get delta P pump is equal to HP times rho G, which you can then sub into the equation. So now we get a value, we get the work flow rate is equal to Q times HP times rho times G. And if you're like, wait, but what is HP? You can take either of the equations from part B and sub those in for HP. Let's do a little arrow there for HP. And regardless of where 22 is, you get the same answer. And basically, you can just plug all of that in. And once again, just in the nature of time, I'm not going to write out all the different terms. But you will get an answer of 26968. The units for this are in watts. But here, remember, folks, it asks us for specific units. It says kilowatts. So we'll just be like, okay, that'll be 26.97 kilowatts as our final answer. More parts to this question, because it's just never ending. It asks us to figure out the pump efficiency. So this is pretty straightforward. Efficiency is equal to basically the work done over the work input. And then you just times it by 100 to get it in percentage. So here we calculated the work done to be 26.97 kilowatts. And we know that the input is 32 kilowatts times 100%. You end up with a value of 84.3%. So that's pretty straightforward. It's nice. And now it's like, okay, here's a conceptual question. Because I like to throw us off is, it's like, okay, now assume that the flow rate we got is like actually way higher than we want. So basically what we want is we want to decrease it. So we want to decrease the flow rate. And how do we do that? Is by adjust valve. And here it's giving us two options. So do we want the gate or the butterfly valve? So basically closing any valve will decrease the volumetric flow rate. So we're like, okay, how do we do that? And so we look at that, we can go back here and there's writing all over it, but if I kind of erase all of this, like, okay, we want to see what's different about these valves. So the first thing that I noticed when I was doing this is that, oh, the butterfly valve is already kind of closed. You know, it's at an angle of 10 degrees. Maybe that's important. But the other key thing to note here is the location. So the butterfly valve is after the gate or after the pump, and the gate valve is before the pump. So if we're thinking about this, we're like, how would that affect things, right? And we're like, okay, what's really important? Because the pump's in the middle. Like, this entire question is about pumps. What is really important about pumps, right? And what has been stressed many, many times in lectures is that basically with pumps, then we need the net pump suction head, like basically output needs to be greater than the net pump suction head required, right? And if that doesn't happen, then you're going to get cavitation. So if not, then you get cavitation, which is not very fun, not a good time. And the way that we can, and basically the NPSHA, if you look at the equation for it, basically that is based off the P, you know, we get that off of the P inlet. So we want to have a really high, pressure going into the pump. And so if we closed a valve going into the pump, that's going to decrease the pressure going into the pump. And if we have a decreased inlet pressure, that's going to be a decreased net pump suction head, which would make it a lot more likely to have cavitation. So the key here is that we want the butterfly valve. And the reason for this is that it's after the pump. So it would not affect the NPSHA. And that just means it's less likely to undergo cavitation. So just ask for a brief explanation. So basically, as long as you say, oh yeah, it's after pump, wouldn't affect the NPSHA, so it wouldn't hurt cavitation, I'm sure that's fine. That'd be a solid answer. So that was a beefy question. I'll just take a break. Also, I'm just going to, like, I didn't have time to think about how to actually aptly word this pun, but I'm just going to, like, full steam ahead, full send it. So say you're working on this question. Or say you're designing a system like in this question. Who would you hire to make sure that the pump works properly, Who would you hire to make sure that the pump undergoes this rule, like it has to follow the rules for the NPSHA? You could hire a pump hire, like an umpire in base. I thought it was really funny in my head. I was like, I am too tired for this. But I can see your face. You're disappointed in me.
We got a laugh emoji, so at least someone else is entertained.
Give me that laugh emoji. I appreciate you. I'm entertained by myself, but that's what counts. Okay, moving on after that disgusting embarrassment of a pun. We're given this question here, and this is kind of a funky question. I looked at this diagram for like 5 minutes being like, what on earth is happening? So we'll just go through it really quickly, because basically it's some figure, some stuff happens, whatever. And we're like, okay, numbers, that's what's important. Is there some sort of bottomless liquid with the density, and it's at the base of some sort of pump, blah, blah, blah. And then it's like, okay, it's given some sort of liters per minute, something, something, something. And that's kind of all that's really important. So if we look at this entire diagram, I got very overwhelmed. I was like, what on earth is going on? I don't understand anything. I'm going to fail this test. Oh my gosh. And then you actually lead through the question and you're like, I don't need to know anything, Willie. Or we don't need to know the majority of it, right? So we kind of can just ignore most of that theory at the beginning of it on how it works. The key is to know are just the numbers that I highlighted, basically. So the first question is like, okay, we need to figure out the net pump suction head required. And here, it was already done by the solutions manual. I couldn't get rid of it. But basically, it's like the net pump suction head required is going to be this little bottom section at the bottom of a pump curve. So we're going to go and we're going to find the flow rate. So 150 liters per minute. So I kind of cut it off here, but this scale corresponds to that one there, or like that title on this corresponds to that scale there. So we're going to find 1150 on the bottom scale here to correspond with units, and then just kind of carry it across. We're going to find an intersection with the 9-inch impeller because we know it's a 9-inch impeller from the question. And then once we have that intersection, we just write across, be like, okay, what is the NPSHR? And here we can see that this one's in meters, so we're going to get a value of 4 meters. So it's just kind of reading off of the graph there. Next. Basically, we're given some sort of height of the bottom's liquid equal to 2 meters, and we want to find a vertical position of some sort of pump relative to the bottom. So here, again, it's a really kind of complicated situation. And for me, I spent a lot of time trying to figure out what was actually going on. But if you can just kind of look at the equations and be like, okay, what actually do I need to calculate here? What do I need to know? Then I think that's what's most important, as opposed to actually understanding what's going on. Like, what is a bottom's liquid? I could not tell you. So I'm just going to, again, when you don't know where to start, personally, I just throw out all my givens. So we know that NPSHR is equal to 4 meters. So we're like, okay, what would be the NPSHA then? We're like, oh, let's just try and get off that. And this is where I disagree with the solutions manual, but we'll go with what it says, that it said that it should be 1.1 times the NPSHR. However, Vince said, because this includes basically, remember, to avoid cavitation, we need the NPSHA to be greater than NPSHR. So the absolute minimum you can have is when they're equal, right? The absolute minimum value. I'll get back to you after I finish explaining this. Basically, that's the absolute minimum value. So that's what I figured we'd be calculating here. But the solutions, basically what you can do is you can add some sort of safety factor to make sure that it's big enough. So we generally do 1.1 because that's like 10%, right? The 0.1 is equal to 10%. So you get a 10% buffer region there. And it just assumed that we would do that. And I was like, oh, I did not do that. I need to rewrite everything. But on the actual test, then Vince said he would tell us. So I wouldn't worry too much about that. Just kind of key for why I'm doing that in this question. Going back to how I got 4, it's just reading off of this graph, basically. It's hard because everything's already drawn on it. But the first step is be like, okay, well, where are we on the x-axis? We're at a given flow rate, 1150 liters per minute. We go along it. We're on this, you know, the bottom one, which I cut off the title for, but on the bottom one, of the capacity, we find 1150. I'll do this in purple. 1150, and then we go up, and then we know that it's a 9-inch. Impeller, because that's also given in the question. We know it's 9 inches. So we go until it intersects with the 9-inch. So that's right up there. And then basically we just read off of the y-axis where we're at, because the y-axis gives the NPSHR. And we want to make sure we're in meters, which gives us 4. Hopefully that kind of makes sense. It's a little hard to see because of the red all over it already. And it's not a super great image, but Yeah. Back to just kind of writing out all of our knowns. I'm going to write, basically, I'm going to redraw what's important basically here is we're dealing with the bottom's liquid, right? And we're given some sort of centrifugal pump relative to it. So if we go back to our little diagram up here, we'll be like, okay, what's actually important? The bottom's liquid and the pump. So basically, if we write this, we have some sort of liquid, then we have some sort of pump, and then it'll go, and then it's going to be vaporized. And this is like the all that's actually important of this entire diagram is figuring out that this is pump. And yeah, so I'm just gonna carry that down so I can reference it down there. And I'm going to define two different, yeah, basically we're given that this, I'm just gonna call this, or this is gonna be point one here, right? Because that's kind of like the inlet going into the pump. So we know that P1 given to us in the equation is at 1.5 atmospheres. So P1 is equal to 1.5 atmospheres, which if you convert will be equal to 151.98 kilopascals. And then in here, when it's being vaporized, so that's in this little white compartment here where I wrote that. Then we know that the vapor pressure is going to be P is 74.95 kilopascals. I know that we know that the density, which was given in part A, or given at the very beginning, I'm not going to scroll up, but the density is 791 kilograms per meters cubed. Or actually, I will scroll up. Basically, we're given the density already. I highlighted it, and we're given the flow rate of 1150 liters per minute. So I'll write that as well. Q 1150 liters per minute, which if you convert, because I'm not a fan of minutes, that's 1 point, or we can keep it in minutes, but we always want to put this into SI units, right? So we want to put it into meters cubed per minute. We will end up with a value of 1.150 meters cubed per minute. And I, like I said, I like to put in SI units, so into seconds as opposed to minutes. But here we see in the equation later that it gives us some other value and it's in meter cubed per minute. So we're like, okay, I'll leave it as minute just for that. Running that out, we know that all the head loss is this equation here. So I'll write that HLT is equal to 6.83 meters cubed per minute. Yeah, so now we have all of these and we can be like, okay, what do we use now? What's going on? So a key thing you can do is be like, okay, it's a pump. Chances are we're dealing with the net pressure suction head, or the NPSH. And we want to figure out the vertical position. So when I did this, then I tried to like, I was like, okay, maybe the Bernoulli equation, because that's kind of a good fallback when I don't know what's going on. And I couldn't really do anything with the Bernoulli's equation. So when you try something and you're like, wait, nothing is working, try something else, see if that works. So here, we're going to pretend we went through that process, or we never did. We knew immediately what to do on this question. And I'll just write out the equation for the net pressure sucker head, net pressure suction head. Anyways, we have NPSH A is equal to, basically, I'll write out P1 rho G minus Z naught minus HLT minus PVP over rho G. Yeah, we're given that. And keep in mind that for this equation, of course, everything is in head form. So we're dividing everything by G. Just keep that in mind. So now we were like, okay, so can we actually do this? Can we figure out what's going on? We're like, yes. So we're trying to find the position, which is Z naught. We're like, hey, we can solve for that. Do we have everything else? We do. Wow. So you can rearrange this equation to get Z naught is equal to P1 over rho G. Yeah, so now we're just given this equation, and again, it's just taking all these values and plugging them in. And I'm not going to write that out because it's already 820. So if you do all that, you'll end up with the value of Z naught equal to negative 3.5058 meters. And you might just see that immediately be like, whoa, it's a negative value. I don't know what's going on. But the Z, if we have a negative value, that's actually side note for conceptual reasons. A negative Z naught value, so basically that represents where the pump is below that initial liquid, right? So this is if I were to write this, we have between 0.1, which we took as the top, and going down, that's going to be equal, or actually be going up. This value here is equal to z naught. So we have a negative value, which means that it's like kind of below it. My bad. It's going to be going. Anyways, whichever way you want to picture this, I don't know which way to draw the area to make it seem easiest. But basically, we have the pump below the actual tank, or below where the liquid's being input from. And when you have a negative value, if we just look at this equation here for the net pressure suction head, then that's going to make this term, if we have a negative of a negative, we're going to have some positive terms. We're going to be adding something positive. And when you're adding that, then you're actually increasing the NPSHA, which is a good thing, because remember, when you increase the NPSHA, that makes it bigger and bigger than the NPSHR, which means that you're less likely to have cavitation. So that's why generally we put the pumps below the actual tanks or below the reservoirs. So basically, that's why it's negative. It just represents that it's below it. But keep in mind that we want the distance. We're not looking just for Z naught. We're looking for relative to the bottom of the column. So this whole distance in here, you know, this whole distance is equal to Z naught. We only want this distance here. I'll just denote it by D. So to figure that out, we want to use the fact that the height of the bottom's liquid is 2 meters. So that just represents this distance there is equal to 2 meters. So basically, to figure out D is going to be Z naught. I feel like my notion for negative versus positive signs, I don't know how to explain it properly, but if you just conceptualize it, you're like, okay, it's going to be Z naught plus D, for example, like for the plus the absolute value, whatever way you want to think about it, we'll end up with a value of like negative 3.5058 plus 2. You'll end up with a value of the distance there to be equal to negative 1.51 meters. So that's just, again, the value between the height of the pump and the bottom of the bottom's liquid. Then the final question on this test, was just basically, okay, so that was based off the average height of the bottom's liquid, but it actually fluctuates during the operation. And here we're given some sort of answer, and it's like, okay, so what, how would you actually adjust your answer? So here we're like, okay, so the height's going to be changing, right? And we want to figure out, like, what is that height? So I'm just going to find, the first thing I'm going to do is going to find the extreme. So the lowest height it has is 1.6, and then the highest height it has is 2.4. So we know that the distance, if we look at that diagram again. Whoa. Let's bring it back down here. We know that that distance that we're solving for, you know, is going to be the difference between the height of the bottom liquid, I'll just call that H, and the Z naught value. And remember, basically, we want to have the biggest Z naught value possible, right? We want to have the biggest Z naught value possible, or the biggest like absolute value. So we want to have the greatest distance possible. You know, we want this distance to be as big as possible, because then remember, that's a really large negative number. That means that it ends up increasing the NPSHA. So to do that, then basically we're going to take the smallest height here, which I feel like I have a hard time explaining it with words, but if you see it by math, then we can figure it out. So we know that Z naught that we calculated is like negative 3.51 plus H. So let's do test one where we do it low. So we could do that's equal to negative 3.51 plus 1.6. We end up with a value of negative 1.91. What about if we take the highest value? So that's going to be negative 3.51 plus 2.4. So remember, we're just taking the value we solve for the Z naught just from the equation for the NPSHA. And we're like, okay. Answer. And if you add that up, you'll get a value. Negative 1.11. So you're like, okay, which one of these would be better? Do we want to have a big distance, or do we want to have a small distance? And we want to have a big distance. So we're going to end up going with this value there of negative 9.11, negative 1.91. Because remember, having the bigger distance, if we go back to the equation for the NPSHA, that means you're going to have a bigger distance there, negative Z naught, which means that you're going to have which means that you're going to have less of a likelihood of having that cavitation happening. So that is that test. Hopefully it didn't go too fast. It's currently 8:27, so this will definitely go past 8:30. I'll open up the floor for questions now, either about the test or other questions, and then we have Anushri here as well who can help answer. Otherwise, then we will go back and go over number four, which is that fun question from tutorial. And then we also had a question just about the transient mass balances that we can get to. Before we start, any other questions people have, concerns, anything in the anonymous question document, Huda?
Nope, we are good over there.
So I will start with just this question that was posted in the MS Teams beforehand. Can you go over how to find the volume for this type of geometry in terms of height of the fluid? Thank you so much. Yes. So basically, this is kind of like what I said previously. Is basically we wanted the first step that I do at least is figure out number one. What is the volume? I didn't actually look at this question in particular. Basically, you want to find out what is the volume. And so basically, you can have a bunch of different equations. So like, for example, for the question we were doing beforehand, so for the square, or like for the rectangular prism, the rectangular prism, it's like is equal to S squared times H. You can have a cylinder standing up, which will be equal to pi R squared times H. You can have like a cone, which I actually, what I did is I Googled all the different volumes for different geometries. So I just have them on my formula sheet before mention because I don't trust myself to find it. Like the volume of a cone, for example, would be equal to pi R squared times H over 3. I'll get to this one in particular after this, but basically you want to figure out what is V. And then the second thing you want to do is basically go over the dV. dH, like dm, dt is equal to dv, dh, or rho, times dv, dh, dh, dt. What you want to figure out is what is dv, dh. And that's where you just take the derivative of any of those equations, plug them in, and you'll get some sort of value. With regards to this question in particular, I don't think we're going to be asked anything as hard as that on the midterm. Because he said, like, oh, yeah, that one question that we had in the assignment with the second trapezoid, then he was like, yeah, that was probably too tricky, so we won't give you anything that difficult. I'm bad at cylinders, but let's see. The volume of a cylinder is pi r squared h, but in this case, it's not h. So that's going to be, yeah, got to be honest. I can't do this on the spot. I know you posted this beforehand. I was like, oh, I can do that. And I really can't. Anushri, do you, if, I don't know if she's still on the call, but if anyone has an idea on like how to actually deal with the geometry of that, just like drop it in the chat or unmute yourself. Allison, go for it.
Hi, can you hear me okay? Yeah, so I was looking it up earlier today, and I believe there's some sort of fancy like polar coordinate integration derivation for this. And actually, I talked to Vince earlier today, and he said, basically, don't worry about it.
Fantastic. You said polar coordinates, and I was like, oh, God, no. So, amazing. That makes me feel a lot better, because I was like, oh, gosh. Alrighty. For this last question, could you also argue that you'd want to prepare for the worst-case scenario when the z-naught value is the smallest in magnitude? Oh, yes. Also, that's good. Is that not as a smallest magnitude value? Oh. Allison, when you put that question about like the worst case scenario, we're talking about this part C here.
Yeah, I was thinking of part C.
Yeah. So I think what we're doing here is like when you want to just for the worst case scenario. Then you'd have to, because then we have the small z naught value, then you'd want to change the NPSH A, right? You'd want to increase that if you could, I want to say. Basically, what we're given is we're like, okay, what is we're not kind of looking, we're not trying to adjust with the z naught value, but we're trying to figure out what is the best z naught value. Like we're deciding where to place it. So we don't necessarily want the worst case scenario. We want the best case scenario. Like we are basically, how to word this? We want to ensure that the NPSHA is always at least, like as a bare minimum, the value that we're given. Like, and that value is like the 1.1 times NPSHR, so that'd be 4.4. And when we figure that out, like the bare minimum Z is this value that we solved for already. So that kind of already is the worst case scenario. Like, oh yeah, that's the bare minimum. So we don't want to have anything, let me figure that out. So we don't want to have anything more positive than that, or anything like with an absolute negative, absolute value smaller than that. Like we want to have the biggest decrease in height as possible. So basically that's kind of, basically that's why this one would be better, because when you have the low level of liquid, then it's like we get that we get this greater height, because this is the height that's actually required in the initial equation, right? You plug that in, that's the height that's physically required to have the adequate NPSHA. Because if you plugged in the second value that we solved for, like the highest or the bigger value, when you plug that in, you get a lower NPSHA value. And we can't have anything that's lower. Okay, you got it. Fantastic. Next for question five. Can we go over why I picked the butterfly valve again? Yes. So basically the butterfly valve is this is a similar concept as we're just going over, is we want to make sure that we have the appropriate NPSHA. So like I'm just gonna redraw it. We have some sort of pump, then we have the gate, then we have pump. And then we have, I'll just call it fly for the butterfly. And we're like, okay, which of these valves do we adjust? So we want to overall, we want to decrease Q, but we can't decrease NPSHA. So we're like, okay, wait, what is NPSHA? Let's just remember. So if we type out, we write out the equation, NPSHA is equal to P1 over, where is that equation? NPSHA is equal to P, or like P inlet over PG plus V inlet squared over 2G minus PVP over rho G. Or that's one of the equations. There's another equation, like that's different than the equation we used for question six, just because this is generally a bit more difficult to use. But anyways, if we're given this, then basically we're like, okay, so if we can't decrease the NPSHA, that means that the V inlet, this cannot decrease, right? We can't have that lower anymore. So if you were to close the gate valve, right? Or if you were to close that, then you're going to decrease the velocity here. And overall, that's still going to decrease the volumetric flow rate. But that's, you know, that's going to decrease the velocity going into the pump. That's going to decrease the NPSHA. That's not very good. We don't like that. And the alternative, if you close the butterfly valve, then we decrease the volumetric flow rate, but we don't change the NPSHA, because we're not dealing with the pump anymore. Like it doesn't affect the pump at all. So that's why we want to close the butterfly valve instead. Does that kind of make sense? I'm not hearing anything, not seeing anything. Yes, makes sense. Fantastic. If there are no further questions, I will go through question four now. Where can we get the slides that show how to calculate the power of a pump? Huda, can you find out where those are? Thank you. So I'll start with question four. When I was solving this, I plugged it into my calculator like 8 times and I kept getting different answers, and it was really frustrating, which is kind of why I wanted to skip it, because I was mad at the question, but we will do it anyways. I'll get over my anger towards my calculator. Anyways, we're given some large pipeline and we're like, okay, it has a certain diameter, and it's then transporting some liquid with those values across very long distances. Then we're given some sort of volumetric flow rate, and we want to figure out what the pressure drop is over some sort of length with an overall increase in elevation of that. And it could ignore any effects of minor losses. So, as per usual, I'm going to start by writing out all of my variables, because I'm like this, and I'm like, oh, that's probably going to be a Bernoulli equation kind of question, and that just seems like a lot of work, and I am lazy, and I don't want to keep like looking in the question to find out what variables are, so I'm just going to write them all down so I don't screw up when I'm actually solving this. So the first thing is the diameter is equal to 0.75 meters. 0.75 meters, and we know that the density is equal, density is equal to 850 kilograms per meters cubed. Viscosity is 0.009 pascals second. Next, we're given the flow rate. So I'm just going to draw this to the side. So we know that the flow rate is in US barrels per day, which I just do as USB. Because I like to imagine little USBs flowing through. I just think it's kind of funny. They're in USB per day. And basically, we want to do the unit conversion. It's like, okay, yeah, times 159 liters over one US barrel times 1 meter cubed over 1,000 liters times, then we're given 1 day, 24 hours, times 1 hour, 60 minutes, times 1 minute, 60 seconds. And if you do all that conversions, you'll end up with the volumetric flow rate of 0.5521 meters cubed per second. And then we know that the length, let's get some more space. And that the length is 100 kilometers, which I'm just going to write in terms of meters. 100 times 10 to the 3 meters. And then we know that Z2 minus Z1, it said was an elevation gain, so that's plus 14 meters. Finally, we know that H, the minor losses, is zero. And then are we given the roughness in this equation? Oh. Then we have to figure out what the absolute roughness is. And we're given that it's a commercial steel. So if you look in a certain table, then it'll give you a value for a commercial steel, I think. And you'll find, excuse me, that to be E is equal to 0.046 millimeters. So we've written everything out. But now we're like, okay, I've used Bernoulli enough. I know I'm going to have to figure out what the friction factor is. And how do we figure that out? It is through a series of steps. So the first thing we're going to do is figure out what the what the relative roughness is. So epsilon, remember E over D. We sub in the value that's like, again, 0.046 millimeters. And then the diameter is 0.75 meters. So I'm just going to do 0.75 times 10 to the minus 3 millimeters. Or heck, you could do 0.046. I'm just going to convert it all into meters because that just makes sure that my tired brain doesn't make mistakes. And we're given 0.75 meters. And you'll end up with 6.13 times 10 to the minus 4. Next, we want to figure out what the Reynolds number is. So you can do whichever floats your boat, rho v d over mu is equal to rho q d over a mu. So we have values for then the second option would actually probably be easiest because we have almost all those values. You just have to figure out what the area is, so that's just pi over 4d squared. And if you calculate all of that, I'm not going to write them all out, you'll get a value of 88,520 as your Reynolds number. And finally, we're going to want to find the friction factor. So I'm just going to do this. Again, you can do whichever one you choose. I'm going to use the Hallan's equation because that's classic. So that's the standard minus 1.8 log epsilon over 3.7 times 1.11 plus 6.9 over RE all to the negative 2. And if you calculate that out, you'll get a value of 0.0185. So now that we've done all that tedious work at the start, we can actually figure out What we're solving for, because we're trying to find the pressure drop. Oh, it is lagging. Wow. Okay, so the first thing, again, as with all Bernoulli equation kind of questions, is just to write out the generic form. So P1 over rho. And here I'm just going to go with the generic, like the energy form, because, again, I just like doing that better. It makes, I don't know, I just remember it a lot better than having to write out 1 over g for all the terms. But you could, if you chose, you could write it out in head form here because it doesn't specify. And I think that's what they did in tutorials. They wrote it out in head form. But then I got mad because I don't like head form. Pz1 equals p2 over rho plus alpha p2 squared. So this is just the generic form, and now we're going to cancel out terms as best as we can. First thing that we know is that in the equation, it tells us that the minor loss, so HLM, is equal to 0. Boom, gone, done and dusted. Nice. The next thing it tells us is that the diameter is constant. Therefore, V1 is equal to V2. We can cancel that out as well. Nice. And I'm just going to rearrange this equation a little bit. So we're going to have P1 minus P2 over rho is equal to g z2 minus z1. Again, just kind of collecting like terms here. Plus, and then the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to write out the major losses. So HL, I'm just going to write that out in terms of the actual formula. That's going to be FL over D times V squared over 2. And then you can bring that around to solve for that. And now you can plug in all the values. Of course, you're going to have to solve for what V is out of the volumetric flow rate. So, you know, Q or V is equal to Q over A. And I'm not going to type all those values out because that would take forever. They are all put up in the solutions document, though, if you choose to look at that. You type all that out, or you write all of it out, you'll get a value of 1.76 times 10 to the 3 kilopascals, or you'd actually get a value in pascals first and then convert it to kilopascals. But remember this question, sneaky, asked it for in kilopascals, so you have to convert it at the end of the day. So that's the big setup, is just kind of writing out the Bernoulli equation and then rearranging it to solve for what we want. There's only one other part to this question, which is nice. And note, it took me like 4 tries to type this into my calculator properly. So just be careful in the test that you're not like forgetting digits or something, because apparently I do that all the time. So hopefully I'm okay tomorrow. Next, it's like, okay, so now there's a mechanical breakdown for the same section, and there's some sort of pressure differential that is half of what is determined in part A. So the first thing I'm going to say is that the pressure is 1/2, or delta P, is 1/2 delta P part A. So I'm just going to calculate that right off the bat. So it's going to be 1 over 2 times 1.76 times 10 to the 3. And you will get a value there. That'll be 8.78 times, or that's, yeah, 8.78 times 10 to the 2 kilopascals. Which, just for calculations, you need to put into pascals, just for SI units, that's 8.78 times 10 to the 5 pascals. So that's the first step. I was like, okay, what does that mean by there's like a, you know, a reduction and had like differential, whatever. Just easy to kind of put it into numbers. Now it's asking us, how much does the volumetric flow rate of the oil decrease from the value given? So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to look at the Bernoulli equation. So I'm going to take this that I solved for, and I'm just going to write it down here, but kind of simplify it a little bit. We know delta P over rho is equal to G delta Z, or delta Z, plus FL over D V squared over 2. And we want to figure out how much the volumetric flow rate decreased. So the volumetric flow rate is related to the velocity. So here we're going to solve for the velocity. You can also, because it's open book, of course, we can look at our notes where he wants, like Vince went through all the different situations we could be given. And it's like, oh, what are you solving for? What are the steps you need to do? And here we're looking for the volumetric flow rate. So first thing we need to do is figure out what is V. So if you solve for this, you'll end up with the value of V to the square root delta P over rho minus G delta Z over FL over 2d, and now the square root is all of it, so we draw that. So you have that big honking square root. But we realize for this that we're going to need to solve for velocity. Then we have delta p, we have rho, we have all those values. We have the diameter, we have the length. But the friction factor, right? The friction factor isn't necessarily going to be the same because the friction factor is dependent on Reynolds number. And Reynolds number depends on the flow rate. So that means that the friction factor here is not going to be the same as the friction factor we used above. And that's the key to this question, is realizing that, hey, we're going to need to do some iteration, which we don't have to do on the test. So yay, no iteration. Thank you, Vince. But in this case, we do have to do some iteration. So the first thing I'm just going to call is F1. We're going to use the value we used above, because that seems like a really reasonable starting point. So we'll say F1 is 0.0185. Then you're going to plug in all of these values and all of the values from above into that equation there and calculate what the velocity is going to be. And I'm not going to write that out because I am very lazy. You'll end up with a value of v1 is equal to 0.852 meters per second. From there, you can calculate what the Reynolds number is. And I'm just using the equation Re is equal to rho vd over mu. So you calculate that, you get a value of 60301. So we have all that and we're like, okay, is this right? Is it not? So now we need to, we'll use that Reynolds number, throw it in the Hallan's equation to figure out what the new friction factor is. And we get a value of 0.0201. We're like, oh man, those friction factors, those are not the same. Shucks, we need to keep iterating. So you're going to do that exact process all over again. I'm just kind of breezing through it because it's just tedious work, taking numbers and plugging them into the equations. I'm not a fan. Anyways, you get V2. So V2 uses F2, you'll end up with a value of 0.819 meters per second. Again, we get that value from that equation we solved right up there. From there, you get the Reynolds number too, which is 57983. And using that Reynolds number, you can calculate friction factor again, and you'll end up with a value of 0.0202. And now we're like, okay. Those values are basically the same. We're just going to stop iterating. So we're going to say that it's converged, that the F values are about the same. Whew, take a breather. We're done all that. So now we're like, okay, what was it actually asking us to calculate? And it wanted the volumetric flow rate. So to get that, we're going to take the velocity using the converged friction factor value. So that's going to be our V2. And we're going to take that to get Q is equal to velocity times area. And if you solve that using the area, because we have the diameter, you'll get a value of equal to 0.362 meters cubed per second. And then from there, we take that value and we're like, wait, but that's meters cubed per second. First of all, it wants it in US barrels per day. So you can do all those fancy, fun conversions. You'll get a value of 196,514 US barrels per day. So now you're like, okay, surely I have to be done this question by now. But no, you're not, because remember, this is just the actual value, but it asks us to find how much does it decrease, right? How much does the volumetric flow rate decrease? We need to find the difference. So we want to find the decrease. So now we're just going to take the difference in Q is going to be the one we solved above, or the one we were given above, which was 300,000. So that was just given in the initial equation. Remember, 300,000 barrels per day. We're going to take that and just take the difference between that. So that'll be, 300,000 minus 196,514 US barrels per day. And finally, if you solve that, you'll get a value of 103,486 US barrels per day. And that finally is your final answer. So that was a very, very long question, which is why I'm not a fan of it and why we initially skipped over it just to save time. Are there any questions relating to that, relating to anything else? I'll just sit here and awkwardly, like, I feel like an evil villain or something when I do this, but then I'll just sit here. I'm happy to stay on until about 9 in case you have any other further questions. Carl, go for it.
So I posted a screenshot in chat about characterizing pump performance, because I asked about how to calculate power. And my question is there a like a meaningful difference between capital H pump and then lowercase h pump? Because if you do dimensional analysis, capital H pump is in meters, but then lowercase h pump is in meters squared over seconds squared. So my question is, does lowercase pump actually mean anything, or is it just an intermediary between that and calculating pump power?
Yeah, so this is what I was talking about when Farah asked earlier, is kind of this, the difference between head and energy form. So I'll throw it down at the bottom here. So H pump versus H pump. And basically they're the exact same thing. So H, it's the same thing as when we're dealing with the major and minor loss, is that the H pump is equal to small h pump divided by gravity. Because the big H is in head form, so units are equal to meters, and the small h is in the energy form. So when you do the unit analysis, I do think it's like meters squared per second squared, but I think I could be wrong. I think that's just equal to joules per second. So basically, depending on which one you're given, then that's when you use the Bernoulli equation in either head form or in the energy form. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I guess that makes sense. So when we're calculating power for pump, we're using energy form. But then if depending on the context, we're most probably going to be using head form if we're just doing a normal question.
Yeah, generally, I think. Yeah, I think most of the time when we're dealing with pumps, we are given it in the head form because it's like, oh, yeah, what's the head of the pump, or what's the head required of the pump, which is in head form, as indicated by the name. But either of these you can use to get the difference in pressure of the pump. Like, you can get that from either of them, basically.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
I think the head form just makes it easier to kind of visualize. The example that Vince gave was how much pressure does one millimeter of mercury exert? So mmHg, you might like have seen those units somewhere. So it's kind of like the pressure that amount or that length would exert. So one's in pressure or energy per time, and the other is in meters. Same thing Sarah said.
No, it's always good to have it restated by someone else as well. Any other questions? Allison, go for it.
Hi, so something that I think has like continued to trip me up is like what the delta actually means. For example, when you're finding like delta P. So in some classes, it's like the final versus the initial, but I believe in this class, it's like upstream versus downstream. But in some cases, it's just like the larger versus the smaller. So if you have any input on that, that would be awesome.
That is an excellent question. My best advice is to never, because I don't think we're, my best advice is to not use delta when you can avoid it and just leave terms as like P1 minus P2 or like Z2 minus Z1. And don't rewrite it in terms of delta. But I do think typically when we're dealing with pressure, the pressure is basically always going to drop. So P will drop. P will drop over, like basically over pipes. That means delta P is equal to P, P1 minus P2, because P1 is bigger than P2. So this will be a positive value. But I think over, like, P will increase over pumps. I want to say that's right, but also if I'm horribly wrong and somebody please correct me. Anyways, it will increase over pumps. So delta P will end up being P like outlet minus P inlet. So it's still greater than zero. So that's my best guess, but generally when I'm solving questions, I try my very best to just avoid using delta P's whenever I can. Does that help?
Yeah, that helps a lot. Thank you so much.
Of course.
Thank you.